Buongiorno. No gracias.
Talking about how to retire with $200,000.
Oh, is that what we're talking about?
Most people in this space don't think about retiring on $200,000. And if they do, then they think it's some sort of extreme minimalism, a guy that lives in a house with no furniture, or maybe even a tiny house, or something kind of extreme like that, which isn't what we're talking about. What typically happens in this space is that generally a person, something happens in their life, and that's when they start thinking about how to make something like this happen, like maybe they lost their job, or maybe something happened to their health or whatever. In other words, people typically are forced into a situation where they think they have to do this, such a thing. Okay, so we're not saying that, you know, we're going to show you how to live off of $200,000 for the rest of your life. That's not what we're saying. So what are we saying? We're saying that there's a different picture here. And this picture is born out of our own experiences. And it isn't based on a particular figure. $200,000 is a figure that, well, ideally somebody would at a minimum have $200,000, but it doesn't mean that we even had that, you know, because we didn't even have that, and yet we still did it. So to get to the point in this video, we're going to just use the $200,000 as a figure for people to be able to conceptualize. Okay, and so what we're talking about here is, for example, taking half of that and putting it in an interest earning compounded situation where the interest just keeps adding up and you don't take any money out, and $100,000 would be a minimum. Which, by the way, we're not saying you're going to use this money to wait on the money. I'm saying that it's there for a very long-term future use, like when you get older, suffer a disability late, you know, whatever.
That the $100,000 would be at compound interest that you don't touch for 20, 30 years. The thing about getting old is that when you get old, you're really not going to have the same lifestyle. You're not going to have the same expenses. I mean, I'm not talking about 60, I'm talking about 90. You know, when you get to the very final stages, you know, most people that I've known that age, even the ones that are still able to get in a car and drive a little bit, the life is tapered down. You know, the life is reduced to its simplicity. In that respect, there isn't really the kind of expenses that you think. It's just basics.
You at least do have something there that's a cushion. And the idea behind this cushion is it isn't the sizable cushion that people talk about in this space of retire earlier, financial independence, because we're saying you don't need that. We're saying that it's nice to have, but we're saying that you can live your life now. And that's what we did. So it's there to have something that takes away the fear if something was to happen, if you lose your job, if you can't work. Okay, so that's what that's there for. So that's half of it, and then 1/4 of it, of the 200K, would be as, you know, expenses. You have like 6 months worth of expenses, you have emergency money. I mean, we can talk about ways to minimize and mitigate how to fear losing income sources. And then this is something we did. It's part of the complete picture of how we did things throughout our lives without fear. And that, you know, fear is real. People are afraid of losing their job because guess what? It's the only source of income they've got. So if they lose it, it's all gone, okay? But how to remove that fear. And it isn't just based on having the money. As I just said earlier, we didn't have that cushion, and yet we didn't have that fear. So that isn't the only thing, is what I'm saying, that you can do to remove that fear. There are also other things you can do to remove that fear. But together, then you have two things, or three things, or four things that remove the fear, which is a real live fear of losing your support, financial support. That's number two. And number three would be to take another quarter, because we've got half plus a quarter, and then the last quarter would be to buy a fixer-upper. Now, it isn't mandatory, it isn't necessary. It is something that we did, and it is something that when you look at the complete picture of this idea is that you, number one, you remove the need to have to pay rent. Number two, you remove the need to have huge mortgages because you're going to pay cash for a fixer-upper without any mortgage. And number three, it's an additional form of a buffer where you aren't trying to be Mr. Real Estate Man like a lot of these channels talk about. Nothing wrong with business and real estate. I'm just saying that we're getting into this space from a different angle. And we're saying, look, we've lived our lives in the present moment, and this is one way to do it. So I'm not telling you that it's the only way, but that this one way that we did it, and we were able to achieve a work-life balance and happiness and enjoyment of every single day of your life. So this fixer idea isn't that you're going to be spending, you know, all your time fixing the house because you're going to hurry up and flip it in 3 months. That's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about putting that buffer in your real estate area of your life where you're not subject to rent, you're not subject to huge mortgages, and at some point later, whenever it's convenient for you, you can sell it. You don't have to sell it, you can stay in it, or you can sell it 5 years down the road. If there's a bear market, you can wait. You know, it's not about having any kind of pressure. On the contrary, it's about removing pressures. So there you are with the $200,000, okay? And so what have you done? Well, you removed one of the biggest expenses in life, which is real estate, number one. And by the way, I know what you're thinking, you can't get a fixer-upper with $50,000. Well, you definitely can. I've had multiple opportunities to be able to buy fixer-uppers for $20,000 to $30,000, and then another $20,000 to $30,000 to fix it, and that there's your $40,000 to $50,000. So there's definitely opportunity there to do it. Maybe there's not an opportunity to do it in your neighborhood. You know, if you're in California or some really expensive state, that just means that you may want to move to the next town over, or the next state over, whatever. So the figure is not a hard and fast rule. I mean, you've got areas where you may have to go a little higher for your fixer-upper. I mean, you may have to go to 80 or 90. So there's some flexibility there. Because, you know, the retail prices of houses could be 100, 150 on the low end. So to be able to get one for 20 or 25 or 30, I'm telling you right now, I had multiple opportunities of doing it. There are opportunities out there, and how to uncover those opportunities and how to put a plan like this in motion where you're just really only working on a part-time level and are able to meet your necessary expenses. This is a picture that you have building blocks that you put together. It's not just the 200K. It's the 200K plus being savvy about your expenses, being smart about putting the whole puzzle together, making it work so that you can literally, with $200,000, remove the fear out of your life, add back the time that you want, the balanced life that you want, the time for friends, for family, for hobbies. Have it all, in other words. Take care of your health and not put this aside for 20 to 30 years, which, you know, by the way, back in the day when I was starting out in this space, the school of thought that was being promoted at the time was that you had to consider putting away enough money for your retirement. The premise was to maintain the present lifestyle in conjunction with the same expenses that you have in the present lifestyle that you have in your building years while you're building up to your retirement. I saw it like Swiss cheese. Sooner or later, it just was full of holes. Because number one, there are savvy and smart ways of managing your expenses. And some of the most notable personal finance bloggers on the internet right now will tell you that the very most important part of this puzzle is how savvy you are at spending money. And not just because of the money you save, but because of the skills you learn. And yes, they do call it a skill. The skill that you learn on how to live well, not an austerity program or
chow,
not being on an extreme minimalism or austerity program, but actually how to live as if you were on a fat program. They call it fat fire. and yet do it on, you know, a certain level of money that would normally be understood as being some kind of really crazy frugalist. We call it industrious professional retire early frugalism, or PIERF. Somebody that was watching us talk about this and came up with that acronym, and you know, we're just going, wow, that sounds kind of neat.
Vlog. Come vi chiamate?
Franco, e tu come ti chiami?
Robby. Angie.
Piacere.
Grazie.
The water isn't cold, is it?
I feel the Humboldt current. All right, we're in Europe. Just kidding.
Come on, Frank, go on, get in. Ooh, very clear though, look at how. Woo! It is cold. It does feel like the Humboldt current is here. Frank, where can someone go if they want to know more information about this? I mean, there's a lot to know, and I think that you're the guy.
Well, it's always nice to be able to talk to somebody that's been there, done that, and has the depth of experience and knowledge. And if you feel like you want to have a conversation about how you can get there, you know, with some help, you know, click the link below and let's have a conversation about it. It's easier now more than ever to connect with people within your sphere and area of life that you have an interest in and get some help. It's easier than ever now, thanks to the age we live in and the internet. Because back when we were doing it, we just meeting other people that were like-minded was just so hard. I mean, there was no Facebook, there was no YouTube, there was no internet at all, there was no nothing. And it's always nice to have somebody right there to hold your hand and kind of see you through things. If you like the video, you know what to do. And thanks for watching and listening. And let us know in the comments if there's any particular area of this subject or any other subject you would like to hear about on the videos. Thank you.